Good morning, students. Today we'll discuss about storage, portable storage devices. We are talking about memory devices, storage devices. So let us continue. So it's called portable storage devices. I think everybody is familiar with this, like pen drive. So most commonly, and this also memory card, and external hard disk. I think these are some what we call storage devices. Let us discuss about storage device. That's we also call as a portable storage device. It's a small hard drive designed to hold any kind of digital data. So normally it is any type of digital data we can use to store. Okay, so there we maybe you can take pen drive is also an example. So this is slightly different from a portable media player, so which stores and plays a music and movies. That is a portable media player, so that can store only the music relevant entertainment purpose, stores only musics and movies. Some are fixed size hard drives, so one comes with a 256 external hard disk, we can say, so 320 and 500 GB, 1 TB, 2 TB, terabytes, etc. So newer units are expandable using 2.5 laptop hard drives, so allowing for an unlimited storage capacity, so which is useful for video and images. So when you're traveling portable storage devices, you may use alternative backing or purging memory cards if computers are available for downloading. So this we can use as an alternative. So this is just portable device whenever, so like pen drive is most commonly you are familiar with. So you can use alternative to storage devices. If your computer or any pumped up computers or run out of memory, you can use additional storage devices where you can copy from that to other devices, even in digital cameras, there also you can use it. You know, laptop also you can connect. Memory card is available for laptop as well, notebook. So this is something about portable storage devices. And one more is called cache memory. So what is this cache memory is? Is related to the primary memory. So where we have primary memory, so this cache memory is much faster than the primary memory. So we have a processor here, imagine. And we have a primary memory. This is a primary memory. This is a processor. So whenever computer wants to perform operation, means it takes a data from the primary memory and does the task. And after calculation is over, again it transfers back to the primary memory. So that's what happens. This is how computer performs its operation. Now what happens, because the CPU is much faster than this main memory, the CPU will be, because the accessing time is very slow compared to the processor. Processor is very fast, it does task and waiting for the data to access. So therefore what they did means they want to increase the speed of the computer by placing the cache memory. This is a cache memory. So this is called high speed memory. It is much faster than the RAM or main memory, and it is placed between the CPU and the main memory. So whenever data is needed first time, so it takes data from the primary memory and keeps, and the same data is fetched from the cache memory to the processor. Because cache memory is faster, it provides a faster access to the memory. So thus the data will be accessed much quicker, instruction whatever is needed from the the program that is currently being executed will be transferred. So these two are much faster, so thus they increase the overall speed of the computer. That's why we use the cache memory. There are different types of cache. One is called level 1 cache, level 2 cache, or level 3 cache. That's also called as a primary cache and secondary cache. What is a primary cache means? Inside the CPU only we keep the small memory inside the CPU. That is what we call as a level 1 or primary cache. Another is the motherboard. So in the main circuit board also we keep them. That's a level 2 or secondary cache. So that's how we use the different types of cache, level 2, level 3. So let us learn about what is the cache. Is a small amount of high speed, that's what I said, high speed memory present between the primary memory and the CPU processor. There are two types of cache memory, that is a level 1 and 2 and 3. So what cache memory, so it will represent inside the CPU, that level 1. So it will represent inside the CPU. The CPU resident cache memory is called level 1 cache, whereas the L2 cache will be the present on the motherboard, that's the main circuit board. So cache memory holds the most recent data and instruction. Usually with the memory cycle, the cycle time comparable to the time required by the CPU to fetch one instruction, the cache is usually filled from the main memory whenever instruction or data is fetched into the CPU. The fetched word we are using means it is getting accessing from the memory. That's the same thing already I have explained. So whenever the CPU is idle, so it wants some data, means it wants to fetch from the memory, or that's a primary memory, to the processor. So then what happens, CPU, it fetches and it keeps in the cache memory. And whenever its CPU wants that data, because CPU is rotating its own clock, because it's a faster. So whenever, before it asks, the data is ready. So that is by placing the cache memory, thus increasing the speed of the computer. So often more memory will supply a wider data word or fetch cache memory than the CPU requires. To fill the cache memory rapidly, the amount of information which replaces at a time cache is called the line size for the cache. How much amount the memory can be accessed at a time, that is called line size. This is normally the width of data bus. So bus, already I have told, it carries electrical signal from this to this, we have to connect. How means it's a data bus. How much width of the bus determines amount of data that can be accessed from the main memory to the cache memory, between the cache memory and the main memory. So wide line size, depending on the cache, means that several instruction or data words are loaded into the cache at one time, providing kind of perfect instructions or data. So that is depending on the line, what we call, talking about line size and data bus capacity, how much the amount of data can be transferred, that depends. So you have here the line size and bigger data bus capacity means, so you can provide more data and instruction, and hence the execution of the computer becomes much faster. That is, indirectly the speed of the computer is also depends on the cache memory you are using. What is the capacity of the cache memory? Now earlier it was supporting only 2 MB, 4 MB, now it's available in terms of GB sometimes, they're not in terms of DB, like 256 MB of cache. That is depending. So if you have more cache means, so the computer becomes much faster. So that's something, it's one of the factor affecting the speed of the computer. So whenever you go for computer configuration, you have to see the cache capacity. If you have a higher cache means level 1, both including level 2. And nowadays level 3 cache is also available. So if you have this level 3 also, the computer becomes much faster. So that's one of the factors affecting the computer speed. So cache memory, that's something about cache memory. So let us, that completes this chapter. As I told, every end of this chapter, I have to learn and write this assignments. So what is PC? What is personal computer? What is the use of input units? What is the, so all this question and answer you have to write and keep it in your notes and read according to, like, because this helps in to understanding what is exactly the content, what you study. This is like exercise. Exercise means practicing, review. So we have to view again by reading these questions, answering these questions, so the entire chapter you will be understood. If you don't answer these questions, you do not understand what is there in the textbooks. That's why this is just to, you know, helping you to know more about the topic which we have discussed. That's why I want that day class itself, we have to do these things. No problems. If you have not done so far, just take the textbooks and read 2-3 pages and try to answer these questions. So watch the videos and answer these questions. If you do not know any questions, let me know that. Okay. This is 2 mark questions. Write this. And now we have 3 mark questions, right? I have explained all these things. And also we have 5 mark questions. Explain input unit, explain output unit, explain storage medium in detail. Illustrate latest configuration of computers for today. What are the computers available today? So that you have to give an example. So that's something about the whatever input-output devices. So next we'll go to another chapter. So that is... we start with the computer programming, that is object-oriented programming concepts. So we have a next chapter, that's chapter number 6. Let us learn about how to write programs to the computers. Like ma'am is explaining the problem-solving technique, how to solve the problem using computers means, already I think you might have understood the problem. First is analysis, designing the problems, and then coding the program problems, coding, analysis, design, coding, testing, debugging, documentation, and maintenance. So this is the actual steps involved in developing software for the computers. I think you know about these things, it's going on, I think so. So here what I am trying to say, this chapter is it's like coding part. So how to write computer programs? How do you write programs for the computers? So that is, we need something. So we have to interact with the computer, means we need some way of communication. So that is what we are going to learning in this chapter. It is like introduction and evolution of programming language. I think we know what is the importance of languages. The language is a communication media. If you want to interact with, you know, communicate, we need the languages. So this also like, what, how do you communicate with the computer, means we need also language. So what purpose we use computer means to write programs. That's why we use the programming languages. To interact with the computers, we need a language. That language is called as a programming language, because using that language, we do programs. That's why we call it as a programming language. Let us learn what are the different types of programming languages we have right now, and also the evolution, how this programming language, what was earlier and what is today's programming language. And we don't go in detail about this evolution of programming language, just we compare. But we have a problem solving technique. The ma'am is going to tell something about in detail the procedural programming, structural programming, and you know, non-procedural programming. So all those things we may be learning. But I give just what is necessary, and we go with the object-oriented programming language. So what actually the computer consisting program means, it has only two things. One is data, other is the instructions. So the computer works with instructions. So I have to give the instruction, what operation has to be performed. Even you look at the calculator, so there are some operators, plus, minus, star, multiplication, something, some scientific calculation. We have different things as well. And also we have a data, like numbers, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So combine these two, they are able to perform the operations. They do not do automatically, but they are separate. There is a method. So when you press a plus button, it does some specific, that's instructing to add these two numbers. So that is what we call as a instructions. The similar way, computer, you need to provide both. You need to provide data, and also you have to provide instruction, what has to be done. If you want to perform addition, so we have to tell to add the instruction, how to add the two numbers, and also provide two numbers. So that is what the computer program means. Computer program accept instructions and data. So that's a, both is a very essential. But earlier what happens means it was, we had earlier computers, we have thought as a mainframe computers, very expensive computers, and they becomes now like personal computers. Everybody can use this nowadays. But earlier programming language they are used is also procedural structured programming language. They have a limited, you know, they are focusing more on data and algorithms. So what is data is, of course, whenever we talk about, we cannot talk other than data and instructions. So that's instructions we call as algorithms, or also known as a methods, also known as a procedures. I think you are remembering the ma'am is doing algorithms. What is what is an algorithm? It's a step-by-step procedure to solve a well-defined problem. It's a finer sequence of instruction to solve well-defined problem. There are many way of defining. It's just a step-by-step procedure to solve given problem. Just you are representing the solution in terms of step-by-step procedure or instructions. So that is what we call as an algorithm. So we need algorithm, and also we need the data. So this algorithm works with that data. So with the, using that, you can do it. So but earlier there was some difficulties. So we cannot have, you know, they are lengthy, they are expensive, and lack of reusability, difficult to maintain. Sometimes even they are disastrous because you are not used this, and you may not be knowing this thing. So when we directly we start with the, you know, fourth generation of programming language, that is object-oriented programming language, because we do not want the earlier programming. There's no use also learning. Anyway, that's, but you should aware of how this earlier programming languages were there, and today's what is we are using. The computer technologies evolved as faster, like some 25s. So that's what I'm talking about. Mainframe computers earlier, today it becomes personal computers. That's how changes it has taken place. The stuff, similar way, the software industry, this we're talking about the hardware, it's also grown the same proportionally, same way, that's also hardware also gone to evolution. Similar way, the software is also gone for evolution. The operations are becoming more complex nowadays. So it's becoming more and more complex, but more user-friendly. The complex also no problem, but it becomes very convenient for the people, so user-friendly. The software and the software engineers felt that it is difficult to implement these complex designs using the traditional programming language, because it's becoming complex and you cannot make this user difficult. So users should be feel comfortable to use the software. So maybe you are using computer, mobiles also. So even you do not know about any technical details, but still use a mobiles more efficiently. That is what user-friendly means. This is the reason of the development of softwares. That's a background working, that's an evolution. But earlier, we do not have that one. So that's why the software engineers felt to implement these complex designs using traditional programming was difficult. So using what is the available, like procedural structural programming, writing such programming was becomes very difficult. So therefore, come up with something else. That's what they're talking about, procedural language or structural programming language. These are the drawbacks. Earlier, they are using these things. So, and using this, it is very difficult to provide user-friendly environment. So therefore, they come up with something new. That is what we are talking about, object-oriented OOPS concept. The programming language that adopted the procedural, that's earlier, and structural programming approaches were programming language. We are talking about the examples. We have Pascal, and also we have a C programming language, and today some still you are using. And also we have a COBOL, so common business-oriented language. This is not, nowadays not, we are not using these things. So generally these languages, what we are talking about, these programming languages, deal with two important aspects. Every, even object-oriented programming deals with this only, but they, the way they are treated is different because you cannot think anything else other than data and programs or instructions or algorithms, what you're talking about. The same thing remains in the computers, but the way they are treated is different. You'll understand how. The main thing is data or algorithms or instructions, what. So data is the main substance for the program, of course. Without data, we cannot do anything. So if you take calculators, so if you do not have a numbers, what is the use of other things? So number, that data becomes a more important in, that's a main ingredients or main substance of the programs and algorithms. That's a method. Instruction and nothing but a program. So for the program, data is very essential. So the algorithms are the methods that are use this program, that these algorithms used by the programs. They found that the traditions, what we are using earlier programming was very lengthy, using C++, what you see programming, it's lengthy and also expensive. Developing software becomes more expensive and prone to errors. That's, they produce errors easily. Lack of reusability. So reusability is becoming very difficult. Difficult to maintain. So these are all drawback. And sometimes it's even disastrous. If something else happens, rewriting the software and making it's very difficult. That was disastrous means you're running the software and something has happened and this is completely, and the software has to be rewritten. That's why it's called disaster or something. It makes the entire software may not function. So therefore, this lead to the revival. So we have to change the third generation languages and result was the fourth generation. We modified this generation languages and we produced the fourth generation language and that is give rise to the fifth generation language, which we called as a object-oriented programming. That's also called as OOPS, we called object-oriented programming skills or programming languages. So let us learn about this. Earlier, what was the procedural programming and what is the structural programming? So I do not go in detail. So next, so it's in the previous chapter. So you can, so the procedural programming focuses on processing of instruction in order to perform the desired computation. So they what is they are trying to, procedural programming means they, the main intention is how to solve this problem. So irrespective of other things, we are not concentrating, we are not worrying. We are giving more importance for the procedure, steps, how to solve the problem. So therefore, it emphasizes more on doing things. So that is an algorithm, step by step, how to do this, how to solve these problems. So programming using procedural language set a threat because we are not concentrating other resources. We are concentrating only on the method, how to solve this, how to do this. So therefore, what happens? It is the length. We are not worried anything else, and also it becomes a complexity of the problem increased because I somehow have to do this. So as a result, what happens? Which could have been very 10 line program instructions now because we focusing. We do it more accurately, more correctly, and it is it becomes lengthy. Underlines of program. That doesn't mean that we should not do something else. That could have been done in other way. Because of the language restriction, language constraints, the programming becomes very lengthy and becoming very complexity. Complexity of the problem increases. For suppose I want to understand again, reading this, all those things is becoming difficult. That is because of the procedural programming approaches. For example, let us take an example. Use of branching statements. So we use a procedural programming, many branching statements. I think you might have come across selection, construct, and then we have looping constructs. So this year we have to make decisions. We have to take the branch. So we select this set of statements for repetitively, or select only this and execute. So that is where the flow of control changes its path according to the result of the test expression. That's what we make. So there's set of test conditions, like if A is greater than B, select something else. If A is less than B, we choose something else. So the control of changes according to the test result. That what is the result of expression? So based on that, we change. So many programs had these routing, and it was difficult to understand and modify them, because when we use too much of branching unnecessarily, because we are focusing more on the doing things. Therefore, and also we have to think other way of whether the program is becoming too lengthy, or it is becoming complex, or should I try some other way. So that was not we are concerned. We are concerned only to find the solution. By doing so, we are giving an option of making the problem much difficult. It's a program becoming much difficult. And also, when it becomes very lengthy, obviously it'd be very difficult to understand. Because when you are lengthy program, means modifying is also difficult. You would read one page and do something means it's easier. It's not difficult. Read 100 pages and try to understand and write, modify them, means it's going to be a difficult. In exactly the same way, the programs is whenever its program is lengthy, and first thing is it's very difficult to understand, and also it's very difficult to modify them. That is the restriction of procedural programming. So therefore, what they means, they come up with one more programming language. That is what we call as a structured programming language. So in difficulties in structured programming, that's procedural programming languages, it gave way to the scientists to develop the C language, which was the better when compared to the procedural language. It was a new idea of programming, which it's called, still we use this one, structured programming language. But first academic this year, we'll be learning this structured programming. So next academic, we'll be going to learn C++, object-oriented programming languages. The structured programming approach was disciplined approach. So what is the main problems in the procedural programming means? We are using the looping, the branching was too much. So therefore, what we do means we make a disciplined approach. What is a disciplined approach means? Restricting the construct to use only three things. That is sequence, selection, and iteration. We do not use many things. That is sequence one after the other. Selection means like if else anyone, and loops while do all. So they're restricted to follow these things. So that is the idea. So as a result, what happens, to a certain extent, it's a better. But still, its lack of, you know, security was not there. Still, it uses the modularity concept, like procedural programs only. The program is lengthy as well. And this is the same technique, but only thing is restricted, that's all. The complexity is quite a bit reduced, but other things remain same. So therefore, we come up with one more programming language. That is what is called as a object-oriented programming language. Let us learn something about structural programming approach. Was a disciplined approach, which is limited branching. That is very important to a small set of well-defined constructs. That is if-else. That's called selection, iteration. This is all the iteration, while, do, while, and so on, and also if-else. So that's by restricting, we can, you know, branching is restricted now. If you're writing programs, you are bound to use only these things. So thereby reducing the complexity. That is the length. What do we call the too many branching is reduced. CLUs follow the top-down approach. What is the top-down approach means? Top-down principle of divide the problem into sub-problems, and sub-problem further divided until they can be obtained the computer solution. So that is what, because we do not tackle the problem as a one unit. So we divide the problem into number of sub-tasks. So these sub-tasks, how long we keep dividing means, so still small enough to find the solution for these sub-problems, and then we combine together. That is how we'll get the overall solution. That is the best approach. So if you're a beginner for the computer programs, or even in life, anything you are trying to do means, first you put a top-down approach. That is, do not tackle any problem in one go. So try to simplify that. So try to divide it, how we can do it. Divide, so that when you get the, when you have sufficient knowledge, so that from there you try to find the solution. That is what we call as a top-down design. So top-down design breaks larger program or problem into a smaller programs, first level. And the smaller program again further divided into sub-problems. And further until they can be implemented for computer solution. So we keep them like hierarchical. We started with like, take an area of triangle. So you want to find area of triangle means let us be divided into three sub-tasks. What will be the input to find area of triangle? What do you need? And what is the formula? What is the method? So second, what will be the output? How I get the output? So any problem is divided into three subtasks. So what is this input? I have to decide. Again, it is divided into subtasks. What will be the input? Like, I want to input area of triangle means base and height. So we need two things, base and height. So now we have a detail. That is where we cannot divide further. So that's enough. So what is the processing method? How do you find area of triangle means area equals off into base into height. So that's it. And also area is A. So when you look at the last line, the problems, we have AB, and that's off into base into height. You can be AB means BH, you can use also any variable name, and also the output. So that has a sufficient detail at the lowest level. So till that, we have to divide the problem into sub-problems. This will be explained with examples in the previous chapter. Okay, so that's something about the top-down approach. Our structured programming technique reflected procedural programming method itself. It's used the same technique because it's lacked the required clarity. There's no clarity, reliability, and ease of program maintenance was the program lengthy, growing. It's the same thing because only restricted and. But also it made the program to use more of this often again and again. That makes the programs much bigger. The major drawback of both procedural and structural programming that it's very difficult to model the real world using these methods. Using this real world programs or real world was very difficult. And how means you'll understand this year programming you do, next year also we do the program, then there's a difference. We do not tackle problem, and the real-time problems is treated as different. And this is treated as different. That's why it was very difficult to write programs. Like everything is in this world, we treat as an object. That's what we are going to talk, we'll understand. But here it is separately taken as a data and procedure how to solve this problem. So that was it. It was very difficult to, moving from problem domain to solution domain. It was very difficult. Like you want to develop programs, what is somebody explains in like medicine field, they explain. And we have to develop the software for this medicine field. And I do not know anything about this one, and this programming is different. So bringing that software for that is going to be very difficult. Therefore, what they are trying to do, what we do means we come up with the object-oriented programming language. So when you have object-oriented programming, everything is treated as an object, irrespective of. So, and the same way we are trying to implement. What we talk, how do you discussing, the same way is also implementing. So thereby it becomes very easy to develop the software for any field. That's what the object-oriented programming is. You'll understand what is object when you complete this topic, you are able to understand. So it is similar to our real life, how we treat anything in this world as an object. Similar way, the problem is also treated like an object, and we find a solution for that. And you'll understand. It's very interesting also, we'll see. So now we talk about object-oriented programming. So structured programming, procedural programming, we have other programming languages, approaches, but we talking more about this object-oriented programming. This is any softwares we are developing, they are all object-oriented programming. That based on these things only, we have different Java or other programming languages, not only C++, there are many other programming languages, but they have more uses these things. That's the programming. The object-oriented programming approaches. So OOP emphasizes data unlike the programming, which emphasizes on the program. So that is the ideology here is to unite both. So it is trying to combine. Both are important. So data is also important for the solution, and function is also very important for the solution. Therefore, what we do means rather than treating them as a different, in procedural programming, we're concentrating only the methods, how to find the solution. Now what we try to do means let us combine these two, data and functions together. That's why it's a one unit. We combine this data and function together. That is what the basics of object-oriented program. They never treat data as different and function as different. That's the methods, what are steps or instructions all put together. That is what we treat as an object. That's you can see both data and functions that operate on that data into a single unit called as a object. So we combine data and functions together. What is these functions we combine in such a way that they act on the data? That it is a relevant. Indirectly, these functions has some relation with this data. That's why only those functions which is related, they combine together. That's what we call as a object. There may be many objects, object one, object two. So maybe different objects, they may also interact with these different things, functions. These functions could also be accessed, these functions on data, this function, that we'll learn. But basically, what is the object-oriented programming concept is, it combines data and function into one unit. That is what we call as a object. A class we call actually, rather than it's called as an object, we call it as a class. We learn that one. So, but an instance of this one is called as an object. So actually, rather than saying is a object, we can treat this as a class, because we want in the beginning let it be an object. Object means something, an entity with some characteristics and behavior. We'll understand those, no problem. But basic idea of the object-oriented programming means never treat data and functions different. The function and data which acts on data, then has to be put together. Like you take in our class, we'll understand. Don't worry, we'll understand. So we combine. So like you take your family, father, mother and children are together. That's one family. So you have your own. This may be different family. So now its focus is on together. So that is relevant only. All people are not living there. So only relevant. These people are relevant, and you or data means all are together, not somebody is mixing. So that is what the concept. Like you take an example of college or class, 10th standard you might have in the class. So there what is means, so data means students, all you students inside the classroom. Class, that's why we use the word class. And we have teachers coming and explaining different things. So they have become functions. They act on the data, on you people. They're teaching something to you. So combine students and teachers together, where in the class. So that is how you treat, like that's how the concept is to combine, which is necessary. So I'm not coming to your school, I'm teaching the example. But only the functions, only those teachers who are working for any other institution, like 10 standards, only those who are there together. Outside is not allowed. That's how the data security is provided, and there's also relevant is there, so execution becomes much faster, something like that. That is the basic idea of object-oriented programming language. We learn that, understand, when you go in details, we'll understand. So now let us, something, so you can define an object. What is an object means? It's not with respect to programming language, it's just an object means anything, it's an entity, identifiable entity with some characteristics and behavior, of course. Everything in this world is represented as an object which has some characteristics and we have some behavior. You could take anything, like table is also an object. Mobile is an object, you know, anything in this, a tree is an object, it has some characteristics, definitely everything has got unique characteristics, they are not same, and also they have some behavior, some features, some characteristics, some features, some behavior means some tree maybe some possess some different behavior, and also you can take speakers will have a different behavior, but it's also has got some different characteristics, humans, each human is a different and his behavior is different and each has got the unique characteristics. That is what, it's an entity. Everything in this world is identified with some name we call as an entity, and also which has some characters and behavior, that what we call as an object. In exactly similar way, we work with this. What is, we have an object is not differ in programming language. Both are almost exactly similar. But the domain is changed. It's a real world, and this is in a virtual. It's in terms of a computer world we have to think. So whenever we work with the computer means, you should be in dual. That is, you should think in real time how it functions, and also you have to think exactly similar way in the computer domain, computer environment. So the world changes. The real world, you can see so many things. In computer, there are no many things, but it's very simple also, because in computers, we have only two things. One is data and instructions. So using, this is the computer world. Inside the computer means, what you have means, we have a data, we have an instruction. That's how it works. But in real world, so many things. So if you are able to make transition from this real world to this programming, because it has only two things, you'll understand that it becomes very easier. Computer, that's why computer developing software becomes much easier, because there's nothing like teaching some you. If I want to tell you something, I want to instruct you for human means, each one of you, maybe you have a different brain, different idea, different thoughts, different, you know, may not be listening because your idea is different. But when you have machines, means I give those to instruction, what I'm saying, the machines will do only those things. That's all. That's how it's efficient. It's easier to write programs than teaching example. Because human brains is different and machines are different. Because your brain thinks different way, but we cannot restrict. But you can focus. I can make you to focus. Exactly. That's why computer writing, computer program software is entertaining, and also it's very easy. You'll enjoy writing, becoming a software engineers. Anyhow, that will continue. No problem. So object-oriented programming is concept that combines both, it's more important, data and functions that operate on that data into a single unit called as an object. It's actually a class, no problem, next we'll learn. So object is an identifiable entity with some characteristics and behavior. So here it is used top-down, both top-down approach and bottom approach. So top-down designs approach dividing the problem into sub-problems, already dividing the sub-problems further until they can be implemented for computer solution. So bottom-up design means it's a vice versa. So what it does means we'll find the solution for the smaller modules or smaller units, and we find all small subunits and integrate together, and we'll find the overall solution to the problem. That's how bottom approach. In bottom approach, what we means, we try to find the complex problem. We'll identify which is very difficult, very essential, and we'll find the solution for that. And then we find another sub-problems. We try to join all these individual sub-programs together. That's why we started with the small unit, and we come up the entire solution we got. That's overall solution. That's why it's called bottom up. You start with the small unit, and when you reach the top, it becomes all this. So that's why bottom approach. So that's something about bottom approach. So let us learn some object-oriented, object-oriented approaches, simple and improves the software reusability, because you may not know, because you never experienced the earlier programming, like structured programming, and then I could explain, means you'll understand. Just you imagine, that's a theoretical concept, just imagination you have to follow. Yes, it is a different, because after this 2 years, when you go for IS studies, you may be having understanding, this is correct, this is simple, but this academic only you'll understand, but it takes time. Just you follow now what I'm saying. So object, view any problem as object, that's what I'm talking about, any problem as an object rather than as a procedure, because we are focusing, emphasis on the steps, that is on the solving the problem. Here it is, everything is treated as an object, irrespective of whatever it's say. For example, we can say mobile. So what is a mobile? It's an object, of course, it's an object. So what are its characteristics? You can see its color, some mobiles are different colors, and also its weight, some mobiles weigh different things, physical quantity, and also it displays something and size. So these are all characteristics. That's how you identify mobiles with some of these characteristics. And also it has some features, some functions. Our features means, so what's its price? So 10,000, 20,000. And it can make voice call, it can make video call. And also it has memory size, something different memory sizes. So this is the features. And like this price is also characteristics. These are the functions. This price is not correct. And the function. Like video call, we can make voice call, we can browse the internet. These are all the what you call features. The memory size could also be treated as a physical 10 GB of memory, something like that. But what is more important, like features means a function, some other. So OOPS consider the characteristics as data. What are the characteristics of data? And features as the function, like voice call, video calls, internet browsing, or something like you're doing. That are all the functions. And these are all features, characteristics. Characteristics are very simple. Weight is a characteristic, identify. Weight, how much is 200 grams, something like this. So color, what color it is, different colors available. That's definitely they are the characteristics. Let us continue. OOPS follows the bottom approach. Already I've told about program, which is exactly the opposite of the top-down approach. Vice versa of top-down approach. Here in bottom approach, we integrate the solution of smaller problem. We find a solution for the sub-programs and we combine with the other sub-program like this together in order to get the overall solution of the program. So another important concept of with respect to OOPS is the class. That's what already I told you, but instead of object, it's a class. A class serves as a plan or blueprint that specifies what data and what function should be included in objects of that class. So that what does a class means? It's like a set of guidelines. Like what else should be considered under the class? So what functions? There may be many data, there may be many functions. So we have to identify. So this is a class, this is some other class, this is something. Like you can have furniture, we can say class furniture. So there we cannot keep automobile as a furniture object example, I'm saying. Like student classrooms, student class. So there you cannot keep some employee, there are some example. Some server come, any different things. So class means there we have to group that relevant. So that's class helps. Now we try to, because we have objects, many objects, where there is a data and functions together, many objects, all are some characteristics. So what we try to do means we try to group them. So how do you make group, how do you combine? That's what data and what functions should be grouped together, and should I name this? So that is what is a class. classes. That is, we try to group the objects of similar behaviors and characteristics, which are similar. Like I take automobile means all type, like class automobiles. All automobiles comes under. Okay. When I take furniture means that may be a different class. There you cannot keep automobile in furnitures. Example, furniture class means that can only different types of tables, different types of the furniture, relevant things can be combined, that only those things, because that has a similar characteristics and similar behaviors. You take automobiles, all automobiles have a similar characteristics, like car, bus, all those, example I'm saying. So they have similar behaviors, they combine together. So this class is different, this class is different. That is what class. Class means used to, it provides what data and what function should be included in the object. That is what we call as a class. That's just, you can define class as a template. It's a set of template, or it's a procedure. Or you can say it's some standard layout that represents group of object, combines objects which have share or which have or share common properties and relationship or behavior. Same characteristics and behavior. You can define many ways. No, class is a group of objects which have similar behaviors and characteristics. You can define certain properties and relationship, all are same. So now let us learn some features. This is one of the most important things which we are going to learn, is OOPS characteristics. So whenever we have this object-oriented programming, why this becoming so famous means because of these characteristics. So it has, it possesses these characteristics. That is, we have modularity, we have abstraction, we have a data encapsulation, we have a inheritance, we have polymorphism, and also we have a dynamic binding. So all these things and message passing. So because of these features only, object programming are becoming much popular. So let us focus on this. Let me I explain modularity, and then we'll go for remaining things in the next class, because it's interesting, but I do not want everything to be at the same thing. So modularity is one of the features of object-oriented programming, or that is also the features of procedural programming, that's unstructured programming. So what does this module means? It is independent, it's like sub-program, or it's like function. That's how I define technically. It's a logically self-contained unit that can be tested and executed independently. It's a one part of the software. We have an entire solution means, that's a top-down approach, we divide the sub-problem, so one sub-unit. That is what we call as a module, so one module. It is a self-contained unit that can be tested and executed independently. That's no problem. You can take one unit and it can be tested and executed independently. It's nothing but 10 instructions or 25 instructions. We group them and we name them. That is one module. You'll understand these functions. When you talk about functions, you'll understand. So exactly the same thing. So this is an independent part, but it's also part of the entire program, but it's also independent. It can be tested and executed individually, and also it can be combined. That is what is called as a module. Modularity means that technique which uses these modules in the problem is called as a modularity. So it's a technique adopted to divide the complex problem into number of self-contained independent program segments. That's what, like top-down approach. We divide into number of independent segments, and these independent segments are nothing but program. That's a self-contained, that's a module. So we have, like top-down approach, we have each module. So each module is combined together to find a solution. That is what we call as a modularity. So we learn something about this. The idea of dividing or partitioning, so doing the program into smaller sub-programs, is to reduce the complexity. That's why you have to divide means, because I may not be knowing. Like a simple example, you take area of triangle. If I say, maybe you may not be, you are familiar, you'll understand, because I may not be knowing about mathematics, I do not know about area. But when you divide this problem into sub-three problem, so how do you find area of triangle means, I need to find area of triangles, you need base and height. So that's a sub-problem. How do you find, we need base, area is base, off into base into height. So this is when you divide this directly approach is quite difficult. So when you divide this and it becomes easier, that's what simple example I said, you'll understand when you do many programs. I think algorithms you are doing, you may be knowing those things. The program, so certain extent, that's complexity. So modularity helps in achieving this. That's the modularity is dividing means the modularity supports. So it also helps in creating clear boundary within the program. That's it, because it's in the self-contained independent program segment. So it's its own, 10 instruction or 10 like input. What is the input means? Only two things, base and height. So that is one different unit. Like what's output, area is a different unit. So what is the procedure? Off into base into it. So all are independent. That's a clear cut boundary. So they are different. That helps to understand. Next time when you somebody try to understand, just you go with the top-down approach, you will understand in a better way. That's why this modularity is very important. A module is a self-contained independent unit of program that can be tested and executed separately. Also definition, it is repeated. So if it is it has a link with other modules, for example, no problem, it works. So let us consider the mobile phone. We take an example of a mobile phone. So what does this mobile phone mean? So it has got many features, correct? No? It has a camera to take pictures, videos, and make video call also. And also maybe earlier we are using FM, but there was a music player you can take, listen to the various music channels, and also internet we have. These are all different modules, all are together. So speaker is also there, and memory is also there to store. So all these units, different, all are independent. So all these units are independents of like capturing pictures is a different unit. Listening to music or radio is a different. Sending mail is different. Storing memory is different. So this is what actually called modularity. That correct? No? These are all independent units. All of these are placed inside called a mobile phone. So in the mobile phone, all these features are there. All work may not be there. So even you do not have camera, you can use mobile. You do not have internet, still you can use mobile. And you know, this is, but individually, because if you're indirectly, what I'm trying to say means that tested and executed, why I say means your camera is not working means still you can make calls, not video call, but other things. Still you can listen to the music, example I'm saying. That's what individual, that's what self-contained, but all has to be together, all together, no problem. If one is not working, no problem. I'm not telling it's not working, but the concept, all has to be together, all connected together. But that is what the modularity, because of modularity indirectly supporting, you have that kind of, that's what real world problems, real world what we have, the exactly same way the programming can also be approached. Like you take mobile is an object means, there we have these modules, individuals, so they can be together. In exactly the same way we can develop the software. So similarly in object-oriented programming, the classes and object form the logical structure of the system. The same thing exactly, the objects and classes, these group of objects which are similar, like electronics, all put together. As the complexity and the length of the program increases, we need to place them logically contained units called as the classes. Like this, many classes we may be using. Maybe whenever you talk about software means, we may not use only one program. We need many classes. So all these classes, logically contained, we need to place them in one place. That is what we call classes. C++, which has object-oriented programming language, implements modularity by placing programs in units called as header files. We'll understand this one when you learn C++ programming. So that's, we include this hash include .h. You can see IO stream dot. So input output stream .h. For all input output operation, whatever the functions, modules, individual modules available are in this already ready-made, just you have to include. And also you can use a math.h. What is this math.h means? All mathematical functions, like in your calculator, you have all mathematical functions already ready-made. So just you have to use them. You call them and do it. When you take SQRT and you do means that symbol SQRT, you will find the square root of that number. Exactly similar way, this language already has some modules, that's self-contained programs. They can be called and executed, they are included. That we'll discuss in detail when you go for this next or C++ programming. When you do the programming, we'll understand this, okay? So next we have abstract. So this other features we'll continue in the next class, okay?